big Wednesday night. That's what I call what's getting ready to happen right now. Big Wednesday night. I just love to call it that because it is big. And of course, last week was the opening of Passover, and tonight the cross comes down. Not only does the cross come down, but we get to put your name, your request on the cross. So you can now begin to contact our host, get ready and email and connect right now, and we will put your name and your needs and your request on the cross. That is going to be so exciting. This will be the second time that we lower the cross in 2023. And this is only going to be done for about four Wednesday nights, I believe, right up till Easter. Then we will take the requests and we will burn them. But here's the key. The key is we're praying night and day for every request upon the cross. So if you know someone that needs prayer, invite them even to watch to see the cross come down this big Wednesday night. And then let me tell you what the subject and the message and the word you're going to hear. Your angel. You have an angel. And what does that angel do? We all know angels are charged over us, but what is the angel that specifically that's been assigned to you? Tonight I'm going to show you scripturally an angel will be assigned to you. Then I'm going to show you scripturally there is a changing of the guards of angels on Easter weekend or Passover. You will discover in the Word there is a changing of the guards for the angel that is with you now that has been assigned, and there has been obedience in our life, the things that have happened. And yet the next 35 days or so is going to be the outpouring of what God has assigned the angel. If we are in obedience and our faith is operating at a high level, or it's operating in belief, that angel God is using to do great things in our life. So tonight, I begin to explain scripturally your angel and the angel that's coming. There's an angel coming, providing as we scripturally align ourselves with believing what scriptures say, it's coming with a new assignment, and it's coming Easter. And we're going to learn all about that. And you don't want to miss this word because it brings miracles. It brings great expectation. It brings favor. It brings great things that is going to happen in your life. Tonight's going to be off the charts. You don't want to miss a moment of this incredible Wednesday night. And of course, I'll talk to you a little bit later about Jesus of Nazareth. So let's go into the service. We're going to worship. Cross is going to come down. It's going to come down, you know, in the front of the service. We're going to go into prayer, and we want you to get your request in. I'm excited that you are with us. This is going to be a good, important night during Lent season in this 40 days that we started last Wednesday night. So tonight, let's get ready. Let's get our expectation. This ought to be a season and time in which we really put a lot of effort in this incredible 40 days that we started last Wednesday night of Lent season, of the outpouring and the anointing of what God is going to do as we march toward the Easter Sunday and the Resurrection Sunday and watching God do great things. Let's go into the service and worship and watch the cross as it comes down, and we're going to believe that God's going to do something special in your life.
mountain can't be moved. They say these chains will never break, but they don't know you like we do. There is power in your name. We've heard that there is no way through. We've heard the time will never change. They haven't seen what you can do. There is power in your name. So much power in your name. Move the unmovable, break the unbreakable. God, we believe. God, we believe for it. From the impossible, we'll see your fear. all she said. So I believe you said it's done. You said I believe all because you said you know it's done. 'Cause you
fall in the category of taking the cross lightly. For the Bible says, the preaching of the cross is foolishness to them that perish, but to us that are saved, it is the power of God. Somebody clap your hands for the power of God. And as you are seated, take your cards. Everyone should have been handed a card. We've already collected cards for Sunday. And so tonight, pass them to the nearest aisle. Pass your card to the nearest aisle. Then everyone watching and in the balcony, wherever you might be, I want you to begin to pray. This is our prayer time. We hear about the prayer in Ashbury, Kentucky. But let me just tell you, prayer is not a new thing at Family Christian Center. Begin to lift up your voice. This is a time to pray. You pray in your seat, pray standing. Just begin to pray and begin to ask God. God, touch the needs. God, touch my needs. And as we begin to put these needs on the cross, they will stay on the cross till Easter Sunday morning. Then we'll pull them off. They will enter the fires of belief. And so tonight, everywhere, you that are watching, our hosts are standing by to take your request that we can put on the cross. And as the singers are singing, as the purple represents Lent season behind me, let us all gather in our prayers. Begin to lift your voice. Pass your prayer request to the nearest aisle. And let us pray as we nail these needs to the cross.
Come alive in the name of Jesus.
sisters, everybody on the platform, just come around the cross for me. And everybody in the house, stretch your hands and say this out loud with me. Say, Lord Jesus,
everyone
of these needs, you read every word. You know the number of hairs upon our head. You have read every word. And in the name of Jesus, we declare with our faith and in agreement with the Word of God, every need, every miracle will be done in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. We declare it in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you in advance. We give you praise. We honor you, O God, knowing, God, that you, Lord God, are a faithful God. And that, God, that regardless of what is on this cross, cancers or high blood pressures or a family problem or a money problem, O God, we know you answer prayer in the name of Jesus. Lord, we know you are faithful. We know, God, we know it doesn't matter what our flesh thinks, what somebody else thinks. It only matters what you think, God. And God, you said, ask anything. You said you have not because you ask not. Lord, we have come. We write it out. We nail it to the cross. We believe you will respond in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Everybody just begin to pray out loud in your own way. Father, in the name of Jesus. At the power of the Holy Spirit, God, every single need, God, every single problem. Lord, we believe in right now, God, that healing is happening and miracles and financial deliverance. God, even now, miracles are happening in this audience. Even now, Lord, as they watch, miracles are happening. The power of your Spirit is touching. Touch right now. Touch every person's body. Touch every person that needs that healing. Touch, Lord, in that family. Touch in that need. Touch in that court case. Touch that person in prison. Touch that person in the hospital. Father, we just release the healing power. We believe it in the name of Jesus. I believe all of these needs. Every person on this cross. Every need on this cross. God, you're going to meet the need in the name of Jesus. 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 There's something very special about praying for somebody else. We always know how to cry out to God for ourselves. But learn to give of your faith. Learn to discipline yourself. You may not be moved by these cards because you don't know, but God knows. Blend your faith. If I could just say, every person that's a believer, can I borrow your faith? Will you lend your faith to believe? For when two agree, it shall be done in the name of Jesus. I agree. Just say that to God. I agree. I believe the miracle. Every request will happen. Everybody just lift a hand. There's healing in this house right now. Who's ever here right now? Let the healing power of Jesus come in your body. Let it come into your bones. Let it come into your blood. He's touching you. Every hand that's lifted, he's touching you. Everybody watching, You can lift a hand wherever you are. He's touching you. He's touching you. He's touching you. He's touching you. There's somebody saying, please pray for me. I'm praying for you right now. I'm believing God for your need right now. Heal them. Deliver them. Save them. There's a mother. There's a mother somewhere in this audience. There's a mother watching us. She's been crying about her children. Something bad. Something not good with the children. I don't know how old that child is. Could be in their 20s, 30s, teens. But I want to tell that mother right now, Jesus has heard your cry. Somebody say, thank you, Lord. Somebody has not mentioned it. You have said, oh God, are you really there? Do you really answer? God, I need help. You haven't told your wife, your husband, you haven't told anybody, your friend, your father, your mother. I just want to tell you, God just spoke to you and said, I have heard your cry. I will answer your prayer. I declare money is on the way. I declare healing is on the way. I declare the devil is going to be rebuked by God. He's going to rebuke him off your children. He's going to rebuke him off your money. He's going to rebuke him off your body. Learn to open up your mouth, everyone, and say, praise God.
Praise God.
Open your mouth and say, thank God.
Thank God.
Open your mouth and say, I believe.
I believe.
It's healing happening. It's happening right now. It's happening by people watching in this room. And the needs that are on this cross, he's healing. He's touching. Thank you, Lord, for the Asbury Revival. Thank you for college campuses that are having prayer meetings. Thank you, Lord, that churches are praying again. Thank you, Lord, there are prayer groups that are happening all over. Thank you. I don't know if you know this or not. Come, all of you on the platform, come, all of you. I didn't just invite these four, I invited all of you. All of you. All of you. All of you, come. Come, come. Come. Your faith is as great as your voice. Your faith is as great. Just stretch your hands toward this cross. I don't know if you know this, but something's happening in Israel. I don't know if you know this, but there are thousands gathered at the wall. The same thing you hear about the prayer meeting in a college campus somewhere. It's broke out in Israel. It's at the Wailing Wall. Do you know that? Thousands of Christians, 24 hours, have gathered at the Wailing Wall. Prayers broke out. It just hadn't broke out in one spot. I want to tell you, God is doing something incredible. Yes. You need to know he shows up at prayer meetings. He just doesn't show up when we sing. He shows up at prayer meetings. And all of you may be learning, or some of you have may entered into learning. But right now, when we do this, this is prayer time. This helps you. Nobody's going to make fun of you. Nobody's going to laugh at you. This is a time in which you're seeking God in your seat, standing. Oh God, may I ask you the question, how many minutes today did you spend with God? How many minutes? Well, this is a great time to take advantage of these minutes to pray, oh God. Thank you, Lord. Whether you're seated, whether you're standing, whether you're kneeling, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the healing power. Thank you for answering prayer. You are good, God. Hallelujah. Thank you for delivering us from evil. Thank you, God, for forgiving us. Thank you, God, for giving us the strength. Thank you, God. Did a bomb drop in your backyard last night? Was machine gun firing from the corner of your streets? Was there planes flying low, and was your neighborhood destroyed by bombs? Most of you and all of us would be able to say no. So we should pray for Turkey. They lost their house last week or 2 weeks ago. They're still digging through the rubbish to find their loved ones. And it's cold over there. Thank you, Lord, that you've been so good to us. Touch the people in Turkey. Touch the people in Ukraine. I pray for Mr. Putin. I pray for the president. I don't know his life, God, but touch him to do the right thing. I pray for the president of China. Do the right thing. I pray for the president of the United States. Do the right thing. We should all rejoice. We are in America. God has given us. Yes, we have problems, but thank God we are not in war. Thank God for this nation. So much to be thankful for. Thank you, Lord. Somebody say, thank you, Lord. Now this only happens about six times. Only six Wednesday nights. Don't let it be boring. Let it be nourishing. Enjoy this moment. Enjoy this cross. Now I would like for everyone to take your phones, take a picture of it. It grows every week. It changes every week. It grows with request. Take a picture of it. I want you to send it to somebody. Tell them, can I put your request on the cross? And it's going up. Let us turn our phones into evangelism journal list opportunities. And as the cross goes up now, let us thank him. Thank him. Thank him for what he has done. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the cross. 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 Thank you for this cross, Lord. Thank you for this cross. Thank you for this cross, Lord. Thank you for this cross. Thank you, Jesus, for this cross. Whatever you need up on that, Lord.
a gift, son. It's in your blood.
My dad always told me that nothing can distance you from God's love. And boy, I tried.
You ever felt like you know the man you want to be, but you're just not strong enough? Every day.
Preacher boy.
Just trying to start over, you know?
I don't think they'll allow my good friend Jack Daniels in church.
You're beautiful, inside and out.
I've never met someone like you.
And I was certain I lost a chance to love someone as special as you.
A year ago, I was high on cocaine.
I know we don't talk about this kind of stuff in church, but I don't know why.
I was tired. I was cold.
I've been watching you since your so-called conversion.
Rock and roll.
It's an infection.
You're gonna try and tell me you've never made one mistake.
Not a one!
You're finished.
Our life was stolen from us.
Look, I'm fighting for our dream.
At the bottom of a well, I can see the light. I just can't reach it.
You're my best friend. I don't need you. You still
love. I got lost somewhere along the way, but you kept loving me. A lost
cause now is found. Never give up on the dream that God has given you. All because of your love.
You still love me.
Wednesday night, there is an angel, at this moment. This angel is being assigned an assignment for the next 12 months in your life. In other words, God at this very moment providing the obedience, understanding of what you know is about to happen. In these 40 days, last Wednesday night, when we declared Ash Wednesday and we were anointed, now begins or brings an awareness that Passover is coming. Something happens at Passover. Sad to say, many, and even Christians who do not study the Bible thoroughly, they don't know exactly what is taking place. Oh, it is the celebration of the resurrection of Jesus. How many's glad that Jesus came back to life again? Get here. Come on, somebody. Excited. This is a specific, as we would call, feast. I am teaching out of the seven blessings of the Passover. Many years of study. If you have it, get it out. You need to reread, refresh what is going to happen to you on the weekend of Passover. There's an angel coming. There's an angel that's going to be assigned to you. Again, I want to say that has to be an understanding, has to be belief, and there is conditions. Now, God, he doesn't just love you, and he does love you, and he loves even when you were a sinner, but conditions of obedience to him will put you in a place in which good things will happen to you. He loves you, but there is what he would consider requirements of, and he brings everything before you. You have everything in this recipe to make the cake. You have everything provided for you. He gives you righteousness. He gives you your faith. He gives you opportunity. So you must read the instructions. Have you ever tried to put something together or turn something on and you didn't read the instructions? How many times did you blame what you bought and said, this thing does not work? To come to find out, you did not read the instructions. I did not read the instructions. I only looked at the picture. I was always amazed when I looked at the picture and tried to put it together. I had screws left over, bolts left over, and I thought the factory was generous. Come to find out, they weren't generous. If I would have read the instructions, it probably would have properly worked and would just be exactly what I wanted, but I didn't read the instructions. You must read the instructions that God has provided for you. Let's read an instruction. Let's find out, all the way back in Exodus, it starts, the 23rd chapter. We read the 20th verse, behold, I send an angel. Here is God saying, I'm sending an angel before thee. Right, there's a good spot to say, thank you, Lord, for the angel that's coming. Thank you for the angel that's coming. To keep thee in thy way. This angel will come specifically at Passover. This angel is being assigned. What about my angel last year, Pastor, in Passover? Does it stay with me right on through? No, there is a changing of the guards. You can read the changing of the guards of angels in the story of Jacob when he was wrestling with an angel. Think about this now, wrestling with an angel. The Bible said he was wrestling with an angel. Now, evidently, the angel must have been stronger than Jacob, but Jacob was like a bulldog. He hung on. I don't know what he grabbed. I don't know what he was hanging on to, but we hear the conversation of the angel saying this, let me go. I don't know if it was a wing. I don't know if it was a garment. I don't know if it was his foot. All I know the conversation of the angel was, let me go. Why? Why let you go? Jacob, of course, is saying, I want you to bless me. That ought to tell you something. There is blessings in an angel when he shows up. Jacob, Bible says, I'm not letting you go until you bless me. But what about the changing of the guards? You're talking, Pastor, concerning there is another angel, and you're saying that there will be a new angel, an assignment of an angel that will come again, and the one that I have been granted, or the one that I understand, and my obedience to the word of God has brought me the angel, and he has led you. What? And how can you explain biblically that there will be a changing of the guards or changing of the angels? It is in the reference of one that can read Jacob when the angel said, "Let me go, Jacob." And then the angel said something which refers to changing of the guards. "I must go. You must let me go. Morning sun is coming. The sun is coming. The morning is coming. I'm not a day angel. I'm a night angel." Which means that there are angels of the night and angels of the day. Read further. Too bad I can't illustrate it. I used to be able to do that. Everything got so technical that I don't have my ladder anymore and I don't have my angels. I love that so much. And I guess we had to take it down because it would kill somebody. So I did not know that. I didn't know it was unsafe. So anyway, someday I pray that we can find a ladder and mannequins that won't kill anybody. And I can show you illustrative what I used to. But there was an angel. The angels were ascending and descending in this particular moment. And the Bible said that the angel said, "Let me go, Jacob. The sun is coming up. There's a changing of the guards here. I got to get out of here. I'm not a night angel." The Bible talks about that the angels were descending. This is where you see pictures. Angels ascending upon the ladder, up and down. And that angel wanted to get on that ladder, and he wanted to take his place because he was not a night angel, and he needed to leave. As an angel, as he was going up the ladder, there was another angel coming down. You need to be prepared. There is a changing of the guards. I'll prove it to you. I'm going to prove it to you that it is in a 12-month period. Now, in this time of Passover right now, this is a great time. Some call it Lent. You could call it lengthening. Lent comes from the word lengthening. Lengthening of the day. We're getting more daylight now. Anybody notice that? The tilting of the earth. That's what Lent is. It's lengthening of what? Light. We're coming out of darkness into light. We're coming out of winter into spring. Anybody excited about new birth, new leaves, new flowers, a new season? Listen closely to what is being said here. As we go back to Exodus, behold, I'm going to send an angel. I'm preparing this angel. This angel is going to keep thee in the way, to bring thee into the place which I have prepared. Boy, right there, you ought to just get excited about just right there. Where is that angel going to take you where God has prepared? Well, check the desires of your heart. What's in your heart? In your heart is, I want to get out of debt. In your heart is, there is something bigger and better than where I am. In my heart, I want my children to have the best. In my heart, I want favor. Am I talking the language of anybody? In my heart, I there's a sickness in my body. I want this to be healed. What's in your heart? What's in your heart? What's in your heart? I'm single. I want to get married. I want to marry the prince of my life. I'm single, Lord, and I'm waiting for the man to find me. I just want to go on record, ladies. You're not to be looking for a man. All right, here we go. Let me walk on some water here with some thinking. Because the Bible said when a man finds a wife, he finds a good thing. I want to teach all the ladies that are single, all the single ladies. If you start looking for a man, you're going to be in trouble. You don't have the ability to choose the right one. Now, you're going to make a choice when it comes along, but God puts it into a man to look for a non-man You say, I'm a man, but I'm attracted to other men. All you need is the Holy Ghost. And you will start getting excited about dresses, not on men, but on women. Their shape, their size. Because God created male and female. He didn't create Adam and Adam. God purposely put into a man to look. Let me teach you something, men. Even when you get married. Melody, where's Melody? Well, I can say this. She's not here. I don't know where she's at. She's up in the office. Get her down here. She needs to either save me or rebuke me. But this is the way it is. Even when you get married, men will still look. I know men, don't say amen. Your wife's right next to you. I wouldn't say amen either. You just have to control your look. Put it under subjection. Oh, you're too holy for me tonight. You're playing games with me. Because God put within a man to look upon a woman, to look. He's a hunter. And even when he gets married, he's got to have his wife put him. Sometimes she becomes an eye doctor. And she'll get in your face and she'll tell you the what for. Let me tell you, your eyes are in the wrong place at the wrong time. And she will correct your vision immediately, even if you wear glasses. If she's a good woman, now if she's not a good woman, she won't care. Because she hoped that you skip town, do something. But if she's a good woman, knowing that she was found by a good man, because when a man finds a wife, he finds a good thing. When a woman or women get together and say, I think he's cute, he's wonderful, that's all right to have those conversations and they're real, etc. But you have to be careful that the fact is that God is God a man? Because in the desires of your heart, you're saying, I want this kind of man. I want this kind of individual. I want him to make this kind of money. I want him to achieve this kind of thing. I want to have a good family. I want to have blessed children. I want us to be able to pay the bills. I want us together to become multimillionaires successfully. And when you trust God, and the angel comes, an angel will prepare. You're not with me yet. He'll prepare for you. There's going to be a man at the right time, the right spot, and he's going to go after you like a wild, hot. He will woo you, buy you flowers. He will open the car door. He will write you. He will spend hours on the phone, and none of you will say a word, only to say, are you still there? You remember those days? Some of you can't wait to get off the phone as soon as she calls or he calls. So when we talk about preparation, that an angel is preparing your future, you desire that your children would be blessed. You desire you'd have good health. You desire things would happen. God, right now, at this moment, for those that read the instructions of the Word of God, God is right now in these 40 days preparing a special angel. As you're praying, as you're believing, if the miracles have not happened or what things have not yet happened in your life, God is preparing this moment, and God has made up your mind, providing that you take your faith. Everybody say, take my faith. This is not an automatic thing. We're going to read here in a minute. This is not an automatic thing. This is a thing in which you believe that you know that when the changing of guards or the angel comes, the angel is going to take you for the next 12 months, show you things, if you believe, do things like you have never seen. In fact, the Bible says he's able to do abundantly above all you ask or even think. This angel is getting ready to fulfill your dreams, your destiny. God is not sending you a dud angel to have a dud year. You may have had some rough time last year, but always remember that God has a methodology and believes in the fact whatever has been stolen from you, God, not me, not the law, not the United States, but the Bible says God requires that the thief give it back to you seven times more. You read that? That's in the Bible. That's in the Bible. Everybody shout seven. Bible says you discover the thief, he'll give it back to you seven times more. If you don't have seven times more faith, then believe this, that God believes strongly, even brings the numbers down that if you don't have the faith for seven times more, God will tell you, I'll make him give it back to you double. Do you have faith for twice as much? So if you have been through anything and you wonder, why did not my angel deliver me from this situation? Why wasn't the hedge up to protect me? The angel on purpose led you in the temptation zone and allowed the devil just to touch you just a little bit. Oh. And we don't like that. I don't like that. When he messes with us and he does stuff to us and we wonder, my God, what in the world is going on? Don't worry, you're not going to be destroyed. But you're going to get this in a minute. The angel and God want a right. They want the rights. You touched her, you touched him. I have the right, and you knew it. Let me tell you, when the devil messes with you and you are a believer, he takes the chance knowing, messing with you, that if you don't waver and you keep pushing, keep pressing, he knows that God himself will walk up to him and say, you should have never messed with my children. And God and the angel will allow certain things to happen to you in your body, in your money, in your relationships. But if you could just see spiritually what's going on here, you would see the devil says, I'm going to take my chance. I'm going to make you go through this thing hoping I can break you. If I break you, then I got you. But when you stand up in the valley and say, is that the best punch you can give me? I will not backslide. I will not retreat. I will not fall. And if I do, I'll stand back up. I am going to still believe. Or, in the case of Job, he worshiped. He lost everything. He worshiped. Now watch the continuation of this angel. This angel, he's coming. He's coming Passover. Now, I could prove a bunch of places the schedule of the Passover is very important to understand. If we continue to read here for a couple scripture verses, we'll get some real confidence that we know that great things are going to happen. God says, beware of him. The reason why people do not have good things happen to them in more than the negative is because they're not aware. They're in the presence of a higher power that God has sent into your life. You are listening to wrong voices. You are listening to the negative forces.
Beware of him. Everybody in this place, you should have an angel. Be aware of him. He's right there. Right in midair. You can't even hear him. He's staring at your face. In fact, right now he's saying, are you listening to that God? Are you listening to him? He's talking about me over you. Obey his voice. That would be the voice and the word of God. Provoke him not. That would just simply be, don't do the things that the enemy wants you to do. For he will not pardon your transgression, for my name is in him. What does that mean? That means you can't sin and manipulate God. What do you mean? When you sin, you fall immediately into rebellion. Rebellion is a spirit of manipulation. You sin. You say, I didn't sin. I didn't kill anybody. Well, you talked about somebody yesterday that was in the church as your brother or sister. You didn't forgive somebody. You can't do that and let God continue to let the angel lead you simply because you have an accuser of the brethren who stands there and defies God. They have unforgiveness, they have fear, they have doubt, they have lie, and they steal from you. You can't touch them. The transgression binds the power. We say, well, but the grace of God is greater than that. It'll go, oh, the grace of God is great enough to say, I don't hate you, I don't reject you, but you better fix this thing real quick because I can't move you into a position. Oh, somebody just say, oh, God, forgive me. Say it quickly. Oh, God, forgive me. Oh, come on. Oh, God, forgive me. Because the transgression needs to be, God, I shouldn't have done that. Get it over with. Ask God to forgive you. And ask that person to forgive you. This angel has conditions. It has conditions, okay? So I have established that this angel comes at Passover. Let me just give you three or four real quick, and then I'm going to go into some scriptures of manifestation and just about 15 more minutes of this, but this is going to be so good for you because I want to tell you that your angel is right now standing. If I could visualize understanding these scriptures, he's standing for the orders of God. God is speaking to your angel and saying, this is why I want to do this. 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 I'm going to give them this. They don't know it, but why don't you switch that, get that inheritance. Don't give them $30,000. Make the thing $250,000. Bring this situation, and it's not valued to be that much, but I'm going to make value be upon it. And they're going to sell this and sell that. And that court situation, I'm going to resolve it, and the judge is not going to resolve it. And just sits there and starts adding up. Now look at all of you. You know what you're doing if you're not careful? You're wrestling with, I wonder what's going to happen next year in the season to come. You shouldn't be that way. You should be walking by faith, saying, I know that I know. I've already believed. I put it on the cross. In the next year, you can't believe what's going to happen to me. No. So what do you do? What do I do? I get stuck in my transgressions. And I get negative and start talking about all the bad things that happened to me. Start using joy that was set before you. I should have finished my message I did at the staff meeting. The interesting thing, and my father-in-law brought this up, and it was so good that he brought it to my attention. After you set joy before you, and you could care less about the shame people have put on you, then God puts you at the right hand of the throne of God. What's that mean? God positions you in the most powerful place at the throne of God, because the only way you can get to the throne of God is to come boldly. So here's what you got to do. You have got to start talking about your future. Now, I want to forewarn you. Be careful who you talk to. Because you could talk to a witch who won't switch, who laughs and enjoys your dream, but when they get out of your presence, they curse you to say, "You're crazy. That'll never happen. And I pray it doesn't happen." You be careful who you share your dreams with. And let me tell you who you should share him with, and he'll never betray you. The intercessor who prays for you 24 hours a day. Who is that? The Bible said Jesus, who is our intercessor, meaning he's listening to every request you have in life. Confess it to him. Tell him what's getting ready to happen to you. If you tell somebody, "Next year, I believe I'm going to walk into my millions," they'll look at your car. They'll want to know how much you make, where you work, and then curse you by saying, "You're crazy." Talk language that only God can understand. What is that language, Pastor? Impossible talk, which man cannot do. For all things are possible with, somebody shouted, God. Go somewhere and meditate. Put the Bible on your lap. Get in a rocking chair and rock to the beat of your future. Get away from everybody, and just in case they would be negative, and start dreaming. I'm moving out of this house, it's gonna be a bigger one. You think God's gonna criticize you? He's gonna say, "Come on, baby, let's talk the talk that only faith can back up. Money can't back up that talk. Faith backs up that talk. And God honors your faith. I will be healthy. I will be strong. I will be out of debt. I will have victory." Anybody talking that talk? That's a futuristic talk. "I will write a song. I will write a book. I will have an invention. If my brother can make $100,000 a year, God's no respecter of persons. I can do it too. I can get a new scholarship. I can get a new business. I can get a new job." Come on, somebody talk some faith talk. So dialoguing through faith. Some of you have not done that. You're scared to do that. You know why? Because you have told your dreams and told your aspirations to people who have criticized you. But they've done more than that. They've got into disagreement, which is nothing but a curse against you. And the reason why some things are not happening in your life is because you've been cursed by somebody. Let the angel of the Lord come and shut the mouth of the lions. You didn't get that. Do you know that the Bible said, Daniel said, an angel was sent to shut the mouth of the lions. I'm here to tell you, he'll shut the banker's mouth. He'll shut the corporation's mouth. He'll shut the government's mouth. He'll shut everything. Are you hearing this? Dream talk. Talk stuff that's absolutely, that only God can do it. Quit talking about your ailments and your problems and, "Oh my God, I don't know if I'm going to make it or not." Start talking about, "I'm going to be more than an overcomer. Next time this year when my angel arrives, there's a preparation and God knows the desires of my heart. I know something good is about to happen to my children. Something good is about to happen to my body. I'm going to have a healthy heart. Let me show you what I mean. When I run 3.5 miles, I run 3.5 miles. When I'm away from here, I run in the sand on purposely, not on easy turf. And my body says, you're ignorant. You're stupid. This is dumb. Get over there by where the water is, where it's solid. Get over there on the asphalt. It's easier to run. And I run 3.5 miles in sand. And this is the way I do it. I look at the sand. I said, I'm going to do it. It's going to take me 55 minutes. I already know I'm going to sweat. I already know my body's going to scream. But this was for age 85 today. I'm running today for 85. What are you talking about? When I'm 85, I'm going to have a strong mind. I'm going to have a strong body. I'm going to be healthy, and I'm speaking to my future. If we're not careful, we hang around sick people, and sick people's disease gets on us. They're sick. My mama's sick. My daddy's sick. Any day now, I should get sick. No, sir. I'm running today because today I'm speaking to my 85th birthday, my 90th birthday. I'm not limping out of this world. I'm just going to go to sleep and go to heaven. I'm not condemning those that are in the hospital. I'm not condemning those people that get sick. I'm making a choice. I don't know what their choice was. So don't put that on me. I've decided to go to sleep and go to heaven. I've decided to not be in the hospital and struggle. And I'm not waiting till I get sick. I'm speaking it right now. While everything is going good in my body, I declare I will be healthy. I will be strong. You're looking at me like, there's no Bible for that, Pastor. You're just making that up. Do you remember Caleb and Joshua? At 40 years of age, they said, we can take the land. 10 of the spies of the 12, they were 2 of the 12. The 10 said, we can't do it. Everybody believed the negative, and by the way, you don't even know their names. You only know the names of the positive. Joshua, Caleb. God said, all right, I'm going to curse you for 40 years, and I'm going to wait for all of you negative people to die. They died 100 a day for 40 years. Oh, let me go that again. All negative people died 100 a day for 40 years until there was a complete generation. There was two, you would say, old men, and everybody else was 40 and younger. You know how old they were? They were 80 years of age. You know what Caleb said at 80? He said, give me that mountain, because I feel as young as 40 at 80, and I could take that. Oh, you're not hearing me. If I could just get you to hear what I'm saying. I got to hurry here. You got to understand, more of this is going to be on Wednesday night. You got to get it. Angels were created by God. Colossians 1:16 says, for by him all things were created, things in heaven and in earth, visible, invisible. So we know that God created angels. Angels were created to live for eternity. Nor can they die anymore, for they are equal to the angels of the sons of God, being the sons of resurrection. Luke 20 and 36. Angels were present when God created the world. Angels do not marry. Matthew 22:30 says, at the resurrection, people will neither marry nor be given in marriage, and they'll be like the angels of heaven. That ought to take care of, well, I can't wait to go to heaven with my wife. When you get to heaven, Some of you like that too well. No, look, we're not talking about that. Hold on. Because we're not in the climate of distinctions of females and males, but we're going to be like angels. That's another time and discussion, and it's great. Angels are wise and intelligent. According to Daniel 9:22, he instructed me, who, the angel, and said unto me, Daniel, I have now come to give you insight and understanding. Tonight, any of you got an angel? If you'll pray before you go to sleep tonight, that angel will come in your dream and give you understanding about the situation you're going through. Oh, yeah. You'll wake up in the morning and say, I know how to figure that situation out. I know what to do with that situation. And you'll be amazed supernaturally. Angels take an interest in human affairs. Likewise, I say unto you, there's joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth, Luke 15:10. Angels are faster than humans. They're faster than human. Daniel 9:21. While I was still in prayer, Gabriel, the man had seen in the earlier vision, came to me swift flight. About the time of the evening sacrifice, they fly faster than rockets, airplanes, faster than the speeding bullet. Angels are spiritual beings who maketh his angel spirits his ministers of flame of fire, Psalms 104 and 4. Angels are not to be meant to be worshipped. Never put an angel before the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, send your angel, Lord. Don't ever say, angel, come. Because you could be calling the wrong angel, because there is an angel that wants to be worshiped. His name is Lucifer. Angels are subject to Christ, 1 Peter 3:22, who has gone into heaven and at the right hand of God. Angels and authorities and powers have been made subject to him. Well, what about, do the angels, Pastor, They then must have choice. They do. When God created angels, he gave them the opportunity to have choice. They are not like men. They have a certain part of man, of the soul. We are mind, will, and emotion. Angels have emotion. That's the reason why they get excited. Everyone of you got saved, they got emotional about it. They don't have the ability like you and I as the mind, because we've been made after the image of God. They have been made as angels. There's all kinds of angels. There's seraphim angels. There's cherubim angels. There is archangel. There's warring angels. We could go through the whole list of all the angels of different classifications. But here's the fact. The fact is that when Lucifer got emotional about the fact, and he looked at all the worship that was going to God, he decided he wanted some of that. Let me tell you something. Be careful with the hand clap that people give you. Tell me how good I am. You better be able to handle a compliment. And out of your mouth, you ought to say just as fast, don't say these words, it's luck. It wasn't luck. No luck has to do with what the blessings of God has with you. You need to say immediately, God is good. God is good. When somebody compliments you, to God be the glory. When people clap, you ought to say thank you very much, but to God be the glory. I didn't get here by myself. God gave me the gift. God gave me the ability. I'm here because God got me here. Humanity shows itself of which side it's on when it thirsts for compliment and begs for people. Make me feel good. You got to switch that thinking. Let God be the God which is your source. It's a temptation to me. It's a big temptation. I'm a leader. I go places. When I go and preach it to the congregation, they stand, they clap, they go crazy. At the end of the sermon, they want my autograph in their Bible. They want me to lay hands on them. When I get done preaching at Family Christian Center, they're looking at the clock saying, let's go. Ain't nobody want me to sign their Bible. Now don't come tonight. I'm not going to sign no Bible. I'm just saying. I love when we always compliment the gift. And when we introduce somebody, like Jensen Franklin or somebody, we honor the gift. We're not honoring the man. We're honoring the gift. We're honoring the anointing. And I love when we clap and stand. We're not doing it for men, and you should understand that. We're doing it for the gift and the anointing and the office. I may not have voted, or I may not vote for the present president or presidents in the past, whether it be President Trump or President Obama. I may not have voted for them. May not have voted for the present president or the past. Okay? But when they walk into the room, I stand up because I respect the office. I'm not getting many hand claps. I either got a bunch of Republicans or half Democrats. What are you? You should understand the principle of what you honor and what you ovate. If I'm at a concert and somebody's going, when I'm clapping and I'm doing a standing ovation, I am saying, God, you gave them that gift. They may not admit it, but I can distinguish who I give my worship or give my applause to. And let me tell you, worship of people is an addiction like alcohol, opium. It's a drug. It's a drug. And if you're not careful, that will become your conviction of how you think you're good in life. Let me tell you, if you follow people because they're gifted, you will walk a walk in which will end up bad. You don't follow gifts and you don't obey and worship gifts. You honor fruits. You shall know them not by their gifts. We are so enamored with, oh, he can sing, he can preach, he can talk, she can look good. We are enamored with that kind of flesh. All of us, including myself. When you can say, you mean they're an actor and they've been married 40 years? That's fruit. Does it mean they're perfect? Anybody can be in the same house for 40 years? That's fruit. Oh, come on. Who's been married over 30 years? Who? Anybody that's lived longer with anybody for 3 weeks, that's fruit. Right? Don't follow people because they're gifted. Check what is the fruit. Then you will obey the fruit because you know God. Bless them. They have the fruit. Does that make sense? Because, here, help me here. We're done. We got in this part here. Because the fact is that Satan, that's what he did. He interrupted a worship service one day. Celestial of heavens, packed with cathedrals of the celestial solar system, of more angels that we can even describe to you in arithmetic. More angels than the stars. I can't even give you a number. Trillions. Zillions. And Lucifer had the gall to stand up and walk right in front of the throne of God and say, give me some of that. God said, sit down. He turned around and said, I will not sit down. I'm taking your throne. Then God stands up and said, who's on his side? a third of the celestial stood up. You don't think people who are full of the devil have influence? You don't think false prophets have influence? You don't think preachers on television have influence? This is why you need to be a discerner. A discerner. A preacher comes to town, you want to join the church, you don't know anything about him. He came from a church, he's been there 40 years, and you know his fruit. You're a sign seeker. You're addicted like someone taking opium. You're a sign seeker. Anybody can persuade you just like that. Because you have the spirit, I want to be worshiped. God said, okay, who's on his side? Bible said a third. My goodness. Are you hearing what I'm saying? How can a third of God's angels stand up in the face of God and said, I'm joining the Son of the Morning? And by the way, I don't have time, but Lucifer was the music director. There's two visible people on this platform, music and the preacher. Two visible people up on this platform, preacher and music. Lucifer was the worship director. He led everybody into worship. He was called Son of the Morning. He heard all of that. I like it. Third, Michael got up. What are you going to do, God? There's going to be war. Always when you make a decision, there will be war. I'm going to do good. Flesh fighting against the spirit. The spirit and the flesh, Galatians 5:22, is contrary one to the other. When you want to do good, I tell you, you will have to fight a war. You're going to have to tell the devil, go to hell. I rebuke you. Get away from me. I'm going to do good. Right? Okay. God said, it's time to go to war. Do it now. Do it now, Michael. I guess Michael, the archangel, led the rest of the angels. And that's where the cosmic void and Genesis 1 and 2, the first and the second verse of Genesis, is prehistoric. And you get into dinosaurs and you get into creatures. Okay? That's prehistoric. And when somebody tells you the earth was billions of years old, they're rightfully right. Man's time started with Adam. We've been here 6,000 years or so. But prehistoric, there was confusion. There was a cosmic clash of Saturns and solar systems. You've never seen anything like it. Hopefully God recorded it and we'll go to heaven and see it someday on the big screen in 12K. I cannot explain to you the cosmic chaos of confusion. And the sun gets out of orbit and everything goes crazy. And you get to the third verse or second verse of Genesis, and God said, let there be light, because God blew the sun out. Blew it out. And let Satan wander in darkness. We don't know how many years, prehistoric time, we don't know. Then God put the light. God put everything in order. God made paradise. And then God made something that would have choice. Because God was convinced, I gave emotion to the angel, but now I'm going to give them a soul. They're going to be made after me. And I'm going to prove to Satan, my power is greater than his power. So he creates man. Watch this. God comes down in the cool evening. He don't even have to even call their names. He just shows up. And men start saying, thank you, Lord. What a paradise. But as soon as they make a choice to serve the other person, God's having to call their name out. Adam! Eve, where are you? Because when he strikes, it separates you to go into hiding with shame. And Satan binds you and confuses you and all that stuff. The great thing is God never stops loving the world so much. Amen? Everybody say, my angel's coming. No, say it. My angel's coming. An assignment. An assignment in the next few months. It's going to be so incredible. I want to hear somebody say incredible. Say phenomenal. Say unbelievable. It's so unbelievable you can't even talk about it. Nobody will believe you. That's enough teaching about the angel. You ready to come back next week and learn more about the angel that's coming on a certain time at a certain place? How many love to give to God? That's a real fun thing to do. So right now, take your phones. Everybody watching me, this is a great time to worship. To worship with what he's given us. To depart, to show, to make a choice. To depart from stealing, from depart from being stingy. Prove, everybody here, prove you're not stingy. Prove to God you love to give. How do I do that? Well, you can take an envelope or your phone, and all of you watching, it's time. You've got to make the choice. You don't have to do it. You don't have to do it. But if you do it, there is an incredible, phenomenal thing that happens to those that give. You'll not get this paying your light bill. You'll not get this giving to Charity of Dimes. You'll not get this buying stuff at the mall. Because when you give to God, something else happens. He opens the windows of heaven. Listen to me. Somebody, he dumps a hospital on you. He dumps all the healing on you. He dumps a bunch of stuff in your life you don't even know about. He's delivering you from. Amen? Anybody love to give? Anybody love to give? I love to give. I worship him in my giving. Now, if you have the devil that you're worshiping, this will be tough for you. Because you buy devil stuff. You buy devil music. You dance at the club till your clothes come off almost. That's how you worship. You buy stuff that'll make you look good. Well, let me suggest to you, if you give to God, he'll really make you look good. He'll make you look better. He'll have an incredible life with the windows of heaven open. It's just a matter of choice. But I think I'm among people that love to give. How many love to give? Cheerful givers. Ushers, go forth. Get your phones. Singers, come. Take your place quickly. Soon as you give on your phone stand, soon as the container, there's a container that's moving through the auditorium row by row. Thank you, ushers. It's giving the opportunity to place it there. For you that have already given, watching me, to stand as you are saying, thank you, Lord. I love you, Lord. Lord, I thank you for angels charged over me. I thank you, Lord, for all the victory that's coming. By the way, everybody, most of you got about 30 days of the double portion, so get ready. It's coming like a storm out of nowhere. People are standing. We're just waiting for everybody to give. If somebody's sitting down, give them $5 and say, here, give this, so you can get up on your feet. Everybody say, I love to give. Say, I love God. I thank you, God. I worship you. After you have given, lift hands, just lift hands. Father, we thank you. Angels are in this house. Lord, your spirit is leading. You healed tonight. You delivered. You've touched. We're going to have a great week. We're going to have great rehearsals for Jesus of Nazareth. And Father, everything that is wrong, I command in the name of Jesus, it be made right tonight. Keep your hands lifted. Open your eyes. Offering is here. Teach you something. You see that offering right there? I'm going to teach you next week. If you do not have your heart right with forgiveness, God tells you, leave the altar, go find that person, and forgive them. That's how desperate God wants to bless you. So this is not just show and tell. This is not just another offering of other preachers wanting another offering. No, this is worship. Everybody say worship. Worship. Gentlemen, come up the steps. Stop at the top, that step there. That's good. Lift our offering. Lift it. I know some did by phone. Lift it. Lift it. That's good. God, those who gave by phone, this is yours, God. Now God is opening. God is flooding. God is rebuking. God is doing something. Get ready tomorrow, tonight. Get ready. God is filling. And everybody say, oh God, we give this unto you in Jesus' name. Aren't these ushers great? Give them a great big hand. Thank you, guys. Thank you, guys. Thank you, guys. Everybody turn to somebody and say, something good's going to happen to you. You don't want to miss Sunday. Take us out here singing. God bless you. Go get a miracle.
Wow. I love that cross when it came down. Get your name on that cross. You can do it by email. You can tell the host. We have hosts that you can contact as the service is going on. You can send in your request. It's important, very important. I believe, I really use my faith that in these 40 days now, last Wednesday night, 7 days ago, so we are now 32 days, 31 days as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. And all of those prayer requests on the cross, day and night we are praying. We are averaging between 75 and 100 praying on the telephone at 6 o'clock in the morning and 9 o'clock in the evening. So Monday through Friday, there's prayer meetings on the phone. In fact, you can get the number and you can also participate in that prayer meeting at 6 o'clock in the morning or at 9 o'clock at night. Pastor John Ponder leads that prayer meeting Monday through Friday. Then there is prayer every morning, Monday through Friday. And Fridays is my day that I come in. And every day morning, we are praying under the cross that you send your request in and we nail to the cross. We are believing. It is a fact with our faith that we are trusting and believing God is going to do the miracle. Now, every request I don't read, I can't read every single request, but here's what's important. God reads it. He knows the number of hairs upon our head. He knows when every bird dies daily, hourly, secondly. He knows that request. The Bible says we have not because we ask not. Get your request on the cross. Tonight, we learned about the angel. We are continuing this series next Wednesday night. Your angel, my angel, what is happening in the world? What is going on in these 30 days? It is actually the outpouring of the latter rain, the double portion in the next 30 days. If your miracle hasn't come, this is a great time to say, I'm believing these last 30 days before Passover of the outpouring. I want to excite everybody about Jesus of Nazareth. You're going to see that come on after I go off the air. Jesus of Nazareth. And And the starting production is March 18th, red carpet. Get your tickets. I've already been told several of the performances are sold out. Get your tickets. Tell everybody this is going to be a great season. Well, I'm believing you'll join me Friday morning in prayer, Facebook, YouTube, all of the ways in which we communicate by telephone or by computer. I'll be here 6 o'clock praying. And Sunday, a powerful message that I'm going to bring this Sunday morning. You don't want to miss the services. God bless you. I just feel very strong that the word of the Lord in the name of Jesus is going to touch you. And God, I ask you to bless every person. Touch every special individual that's watching me. In the name of Jesus, go through this camera lens. Let the person who is viewing this, ever how you're viewing me, and receive in the name of Jesus, the touch of Jesus in your life, and experience what God is going to do for you. I can't wait till the next time we come together and we're going to believe again for great things in our life. And remember, yes, you can.